Good evening, everybody. Honorable Professor Dr. P.C. Shejwalkar, sir. Directors of Sri Balaji Society and our four institutes, professors, the faculty members, and my a very young, enthusiastic student managers. We are very fortunate to have His Highness Dr. P.C. Shejwalkar, sir, with us. He is a professor, and whenever we use the word professor, please remember that he is a professor emeritus. And the university, that is the SPPU, has given this honor to him. And his contribution, not only in Pune University, but in the state as well as in the nation, as far as the management education, is remarkable. In the sense that more than hundreds of academicians and corporates, they did research in management science under the guidance of Dr. P.C. Shejwalkar, sir. If we think in respect of how many books he has authored, then since last more than 5 decades, if I remember it well, he has authored again more than the books which we can count it in respect of centuries, in number of centuries. Articles, research articles, as well as the giving the expertise opinion to the university, to the vice chancellors, and even to the Ministry of Education at the state level, he is always given a very high respect, and his word is considered as the final word as far as the education field is concerned. Sir, we are very delighted to welcome you here, and Sri Balaji Society, particularly the President, Professor Dr. Colonel A. Balasubramaniam, our beloved Bala sir, on behalf of SBS and all the authorities of SBS, a very warm welcome at this campus and at this auditorium. Once again, sir, on behalf of Sri Balaji Society, we welcome you. Thank you very much.
Live not always to conquer, but to fight well. Not to triumph, but to struggle. This is the famous quote by our today's guest, Dr. Shejwalkar, sir. Good evening, one and all. I, Bhakti Datarkar, student manager, Sri Balaji Society, feel honored and obliged to formally introduce you all to our distinguished guest. Dr. Shejwalkar, sir, unarguably, is the father of management education in Maharashtra. Sir started his management training at the age of 16. While pursuing his graduation, he sold small products in Mumbai local trains and fireworks for Diwali to be financially independent. Sir started his teaching profession in government school in Thane while pursuing his post-graduation. Sir was a professor at JG College of Commerce, Hubli, HM College, Ahmedabad, and BMCC, Pune. Sir is the research guide in commerce and management since 1963 in Pune University, Symbiosis, Shivaji University, and Bharati Vidyapeeth. Sir has guided 87 research scholars for PhD so far, which is a world record. At the time when management education was unheard of in Maharashtra in 1970s, Dr. Shejwalkar sir persuaded the University of Pune to launch full-time post-graduation course and thereafter founded the prestigious Institute of Management Development and Research, IMDR. We are proud to state that our beloved Bala sir is an alumni of the same institute. Sir has authored over 43 books, 600 articles, and has delivered 4,000 public lectures. His zest for life has not ceased. Instead, with childlike passion, he yearns to improve the educational sphere through writing, speeches, and correspondence with the power to be. Dr. Shezwarkar, sir, is the life example of leading a disciplined life as he spends good number of hours regularly in his college, even at this age. Sir has received several lifetime achievement awards, including one from Pune Municipal Corporation, Pune University, Bharati Vidyapeeth, and Manibhai Desai Bharatiya Agro Industry Federation. Awards from has been instituted in the name of Dr. P.C. Shezwarkar, sir, for best teachers. With so much to tell you, sir, I would now request you to share your valuable thoughts and experience with us. Thank you.
My young friends, I am so fortunate that this evening I am with you, with all of you, as well as with the honorable directors who are sitting here, Dr. Chirude, who is on my left side, and so many others whom I had met earlier. Shall I say, I am fortunate this evening to meet so all of you. I am thinking of my days when I was a student in the college and in the management institute. Friends, shall I say again, I feel young at heart, at the age of 90, and when I happen to be in the midst of young people. You are from the fourth generation from my side. I think most of you must be in the bracket of 20 and 23. Imagine, in a way, there is a distance between me and all of you. And yet, whenever I happen to meet young people like you, I forget my old age. And I become personal friend of every one of you. Take the case, Rohit Patil and this Mukherjee, Devayani Mukherjee, on your behalf, escorted me, comforted me, and brought me here. And I found they were very intelligent and answered all my questions, whatever I asked. I can imagine that all of you must be as intelligent and sharp as these two young students are, whom I met just now. Shall I say, my dear friends, your future is bright. Everyone asks me, sir, what is your future? Everyone's future is bright. I am not exaggerating. Why am I saying that? It is because you have entered a new world of revolution, revolution of all kinds. Revolution in information technology, revolution in agriculture, industry. We have seen that globalization, privatization, and liberalization, they have brought the whole world together. And for you, it is now not difficult to move anywhere in the world. This was not so when I was a student. Miracles have happened. They are not miracles. People have, in these days, have made sincere efforts to see that the world is changing. And when I say that your future is bright, I must add that you must know how to enrich your life. How will you enrich your life? I feel that everyone has some potential, supta shakti. Everyone has. Don't say I am not clever, I am not fortunate. Everyone has something. Everyone has a potential. Discover your potential. Develop your potential. Utilize your potential. For whom? Utilize this for yourself, for your family, for your people, for your society, and for the nation. And here, Again, somebody asked me, sir, we are very common students. There is nothing extraordinary in amongst us. May I say? Everyone has something uncommon. Everyone has something extraordinary. And that you have to find out. It takes us some time for you to find out what is so uncommon in you. I am remembering here the story of Pygmalion. Pygmalion was a sculptor, a statue maker. It's an old story given by George Bernard Shaw. This Pygmalion wanted to prepare a statue of a beautiful young daughter of the emperor. But the emperor didn't like this. He drove him out. Bichara, that Pygmalion, went to the top of the hill, started preparing the statue. Unmindful of scorching heat, unmindful of torrential rain, unmindful of biting cold, Pygmalion was involved, highly committed to prepare the statue. And so what happened? When the statue was ready, it became live. It's an imaginary story. The essence of this story is that when you are fully involved in your work, when there is full commitment on your side, that you will do it and do it. That is the magic that you have. I have no magic with me. People ask me, is it that I have? No. Magic is with you. And try to find out what is so uncommon here. Do something which is uncommon, as Pygmalion did. The point is, I don't know whether I have no magic wand with me, I have no wonder drug with me, I have no any formula with me. I will only say, you can develop self-confidence in such a way that you feel that the entire world is in your hands. Yes, there are many people, they are so ambitious, and many people have done. They started with an ordinary level, but then persistent efforts enabled them to change any kind of situation. Here I am quoting, situation is important. Some people, again, some young students ask, sir, we can't change the situation, can we not? If you are fully involved, if your goal is clear, if you are fully committed, you can change the situation also. So many have changed the situation. I can give a number of examples, but to be short in giving this, take two examples which people know. We know APJ Abdul Kalam. He was born in a poor family, Muslim family. And for 5 years, he was selling the newspapers at Rameshwaram station, an ordinary boy. It's a long story, you can read it, there's a biography of it. And then he becomes a scientist, develop missiles, and finally becomes the president also. It's a great, inspiring story. Another is, you may like him or not, but there was a young boy who was serving a cup of tea to the passengers sitting in the railway train when the train used to stop at the station. Who was he? Finally became president, my prime minister is Narendra Modi. But why should I take the extreme example? Shall I say? I had seen our highly respected Bala sir, as is popularly known, Professor Dr. Colonel Bala Subramanian. Just 45 years back, we started knowing each other. As it was said, he joined my institute in the army batch as a student. But he was not an ordinary student. You will be glad to know that the army authorities conferred the honorable award of Colonel to Balasar. That was the beginning of his coming up. And then he came here. It was a barren land. And today I find entire education empire is seen here. I had seen it thrice, four times growing. And I felt that it was a magic. It was not a magic. It was hard work that Colonel Balasubramanian has done for you. You are enjoying the fruits. You are going to get good placements. Yes, with several directors sitting here, they are all committed to do something for you and for the institute. Here is specialty of this, that only one Colonel Balasubramanian, he says, I am not doing it alone. My success depends on all these people sitting here, honorable professors, honorable directors, and they are all doing for you. This is the reason why I always give the example of Balasubramanian. Did he not change the situation? He went through a struggle. This is not the time to narrate it. But I can say that really it was a rather miracle that today he is what he is, in spite of so many struggles, so many problems that he had to face. Now this is what I mean. The point I am not making is, I am considering you as fortunate because several types of revolutions have taken place in this world. World has become faster. Not only that, we have what we call as Green Revolution by Swaminathan, White Revolution by Varghese, and so on and so forth. Blue Revolution by, again, APJ Abdul Kalam. All kinds of revolutions. This was not in my days. The reason I am saying is, you are more fortunate than what my batch had. In those days, hardly there were any telephones in the town. There was no TV at all. No electronic revolution. No computer revolution. Leave aside atom bomb, hydrogen bomb. The point I am making again is, those who always ask me the question, sir, our life is not so nice. It is nice. Again, please don't forget that there is a spectacular change in the entire system, the whole world. Today, you can move any part of the world. In those days, it was difficult to go to other countries. And therefore, though today we say it's a mind-boggling situation, it is an exciting situation, particularly because social media has made a tremendous revolution. Let me narrate here some of the things I have quoted Bigmadian, but I must quote very important events. There are many people who were born in poor families. Don't think that they were having spoons, the silver spoons in their mouths. Who was one? At the age of 32, Mark Zuckerberg, you know his name now, he has given a wonderful gift to the world, Facebook. And now the world has become one. Communication has become softer. This is one case. Bill Gates, all of them were born in poor families. I am quoting this because I read their biographies. Bill Gates, Microsoft, brought a computer revolution. Here, let us not forget, they were not graduates at all. They couldn't take education. But they did so revolutionary that Harvard University, sir, went out of the way and gave the master's degree to Mark Zuckerberg as well as Bill Gates. Harvard has recognized that. Take the other case. Warren Buffett, Steve Jobs and Warren Buffett, they were also not graduates, but their investment experts and Stanford University honored them though they were not graduates. Another local example, you must have heard, Kirloskar, Chandrasekhar Kirloskar was an industrialist of great reputation. But he had failed in mathematics in matriculation exams. He wanted admission to engineering college. Who gave him engineering college admission? We are a conservative nation. So he couldn't do anything. He managed to go to England as a workman. And for 3 years, he did work as a worker, though he belonged to the industrial family. After 3 years, his boss said, "We are making you permanent. Please stay here with us." He said, "No, I want to go back to India, develop my industry. But what do you want here? Sir, though I am not matriculated, will you kindly recommend my case for admission to engineering college?" And he got admission to engineering college. This would not have happened in India. He became engineer, became graduate, came back, and you know the story. I am quoting this story because I'm umpteen examples of them. All of them have done spectacular progress. This is not a time to give many more examples. Let me say that I have come across during all these years several ordinary students in my own, under my own control, and they have become great. One of my students, he belonged to the, what you call as, Dalita community, backward community. He was so poor that when he joined my MBA class in the university in 1971, he used to get tiffin, just bakri and onion from another village. His name is J.P. Dange, I remember. He got IAS in open category, though he belonged to the backward community. And finally became chief secretary. I felt happy, but that was not enough. The day he became chief secretary, he came running to Pune to tell me this news, and I felt so overwhelmed. Likewise, there are many examples. I had one student who was so poor, he was sitting under in our BMCC campus, in the corridor, because he had not enough room at all. He has become commissioner of income tax later on, but he remembers the old days. Why he remembers me? When I was sitting, he was sitting in the corridor, I said to him, "Come on, I'll give you a room. Come inside the college. Please sit here," and he did it. This is not the time to quote all the stories. I am quoting it because it may be that you are also, some of you may be having some problem, some struggle. Accept that struggle. If you run away from the struggle, you will never become successful. This is what Colonel Balasubramanian has said. Now coming to this, because I was asked to tell you my story. And my story is not that very good story like Kirloskar, Warren Buffett and all that. But one thing is there, my story may underscore the importance of struggle. I must say, there are moments in my life, milestones, which are very precious. And I cannot forget those milestones. And I had to struggle from one thing to another. Now that I have been given freedom and I take liberty of saying what struggle I had to face, I don't know whether I am talking of myself, not praising myself, but I must tell you that I was born in a lower middle class family, and my early life was full of struggle. Why it was full of struggle? Because my father was a station master at some railway station in near Mumbai. He retired by the time I started my college education. He had no pension in those days, He had no money, and we were 8 members in the family, and I was suspecting whether I would get college education. So I decided to earn money along with my education, and I was working. What did I do? I started earning in college education. I became salesman, and I had the courage to move in the local trains in Mumbai. You know the local trains. So many passengers sitting there, and I started selling them on scented supari, agarbatti, and so many things. Finally, I was told that selling these things in the local train is an offense. So I should not do that. So I changed my sort of activity. I started going from shop to shop in the entire Mumbai city on the eastern side. From, if you know Mumbai, from Victoria Terminal Station to Kadiyan, so many stations were there. And I used to take bags in my hands. Mumbai is a city of rainfall. In the days of rainfall, it was a struggle to hold the umbrella or to have the raincoat and to have the bag, two bags, moving from hotel to hotel. But I am quoting this because I learned what kind of people there are. I found that in some hotels where I was selling this thing, they were kind enough. They used to call me inside during the summer days. They said, "Bala, your child, do come, have a cup of tea." I was really feeling overwhelmed. But at the same time, there were many hotels or shops. They didn't allow me to enter the shop. They said, "Hey, we don't want it, get out." So I could see that there are different types of people. It depends what type of person you would become. Why should you not become a kind-hearted person? Why should not help the poor students? This is how I learned. But then again I learned, in these days, in a scorching heat, torrential rains, going from shop to shop was very tiresome. And again to go to the college in time. I was in Sydenham College, a well-known college at that time in Mumbai. And the college hours were from 11 to 4. So how can they sell this thing? Fortunately, I came across an advertisement asking the applicants to apply for the teacher job. Teacher in a night school. I said, why not? I applied, and fortunately, here again, I got the teacher job. So where? In a night school. Where? In an area which was dominated by slums. We call it slums, we call it underworld. So bad was that area that only the women used to work, and the head of the family used to take drinks, alcohol. It was difficult to move there. And you know, remember these poor students. They used to come to the school from 7 to 10:30. And I used to be there. I worked there for about 6 months. But felt tired because I couldn't concentrate on my studies. Fortunately, again, I got a job in day school. And when I got a job in day school, somehow or other, I could carry on. Take out. Fortunately, I did my post-graduation and started my career in college education. You know it in BMCC, but I was not in BMCC immediately. In those days, there were very few colleges. I spent 1 year at Hubli and 1 year at Ahmedabad. And then I got a job in Pune. I wanted to come to Pune because I wanted to do a doctoral study under eminent guy, Dr. Dhananjayrao Gadgil. He knows his name. And here, I started. But here, what was the salary? You will not believe me. The starting salary for an assistant professor sir, only rupees 190 per month. But the prices were low, some of them could carry on. And we had two shifts. First shift was from 8 o'clock to 12. Another was 1 o'clock to 5. And I was given periods for two shifts, both the shifts. And from a long distance, what was the, it was 4 kilometers away from the college. And from 190 rupees, the house rent was 65 rupees. Imagine how we must have survived. And to go on bicycle to the college twice every day. But the struggle, when I felt, look, I am now assistant professor, so I can win over my students, I can enjoy. And really, I really enjoyed those periods. But then I thought, I must do a doctoral study because without which I cannot become professor. I was assistant professor, without which I can't become principal of the college. Imagine I was living in one room. I had just married my wife and my small daughter. For 9 years I lived in that one room because the rent was very high. And there I studied, did PhD, and my guide was very kind enough. That details I am not giving. But after 3 years, that is 1958, at my age of, what was my 28? At my age of 28, I got a doctoral degree. In that time, commerce faculty was my doctoral degree in economics. And when I got that degree, the Deccan Education Society, which is a well-known society here, appreciated my hard work, my guide appreciated hard work, and they inducted me in the management of the Deccan Education Society. So there was some change. This is only one part of it. I was given a big bungalow of 9 rooms, because now I was vice principal. I was secretary of the board of life members. My life changed. But after how many years? Imagine the struggle. Or was it over? Was I satisfied? No. I was trying to see how I can become. That is under months of became PhD. I became research guide very soon. At my age of 32, it was mentioned here. I was lucky that so many students became PhD under me. But I am mentioning another point that was a big turnaround in my life. You should appreciate that. Why should? I was taking active part in public life. So much so that I used to get invitation for lectures. There was one student, a Marwari student in BMCC. His father had become 75 and he wanted someone to come as a chief guest to say something about his father. Imagine. So I said, yes, I will come. He gave me the information about his father and I went there and I addressed him. His name was Doshi, Arun Doshi. He's working as a businessman. But in that group, there was someone sitting, his elder brother, R.T. Doshi, Ramesh Doshi. I am quoting this for that, you will get some cue from this. Why I am quoting this? That Ramesh Doshi, who already got Padma Shri, who was an agricultural economist and a researcher. Next day he came to my cabin in vice principal's office. He said, I have come for 10 minutes. Oh my God, how, why? You were saying about starting management courses in Pune. Now why I was saying that? Here again I must say the luck part of it and struggle. It so happened that in the year 1963, when I was just 32 years old, there came a notification in the university from the government. What was that? That IIM Calcutta has just started the institute in 1963. And in the very first year, it has decided to have capsule courses for senior managers, giving them MBA degree. When that notification came, why it came to the university? It was stated that, as per government orders, only two professors from all over India would be selected and they would be given free education, free lodging and boarding. I was lucky. The principal under whom I was working, he was dean also at that time. He saw that notification and he said, "Shezwankar, you must jump at it. Go. It is a 6 months ago, we'll give you duty leave." What was the condition? I satisfied those conditions. Condition was, you must have a doctoral degree, which I had. You must have 10 years experience, which I had. You must be now professor. I became a professor. And though, surprisingly, I had applied and I was selected. This is how I was introduced to what is now called popularly management courses. I went to Calcutta. The building was not yet ready, so courses were done in Delhi. And for 6 months, I went through a capsule course. I learned there ABC of management. All subjects were not taught, particularly HR, marketing, finance, and general management. They were taught. There were 30 senior managers. We were the only two professors. I enjoyed that. That was a turnaround in my life. I learned many things from the senior managers, their manners, their etiquette. Because I was a small teacher earlier, poor teacher. Now these managers and these professors, all American professors were there. Douglas MacGregor, sir, you have still heard his name. Peter Drucker had come twice. I could see these people. And so informal was the atmosphere that in the evening, at the time of dinner, all professors, all participants used to sit together for discussion, for drinks, for dinner. And I found this was a new world. Gone are that world which is very moving very slowly. Here is a world of management, and management is going to come to stay. Now I am quoting all this because, in rather detail, that when I successfully completed that course, came back to Pune, and here that Arun Doshi was there, whose father was felicitated by me, and his elder brother Ramesh Doshi, to whom I made a reference earlier, he came and said, "If you have come from IIM Calcutta, done this course, why should you not start MBA program in Pune?" So I said, it's difficult, because it will require a huge building, it will require a lot of capital, a lot of land. I tried to quote, narrate all difficulty. He said, "I'll help you." Fortunately, our Deccan Education Society had a big land available. You know it, sir. Yeah. You had come to that. Big land was there. That was not a problem. Problem was that our investment. And here that Ramesh Doshi, Dr. R.T. Doshi, Padmashri Doshi, with whom I had no relation earlier, with whom I had not seen earlier, he said, "How much money you want for starting the management? Start it." I just casually said, I didn't know, I didn't work out the figures. I said, "Sir, 6 lakhs. In those days, imagine the prices. Today you may require 2 crores. I said, 6 lakhs. I will give you 7 lakhs. Go and start early." And then on behalf of the Deccan Education Society, to whom I had to make a proposal, I had to explain in detail, I had to convince it was again a full of it was not so easy. It was easy to get 7 lakhs. It was difficult, sir, to convince my colleagues in the Deccan Education Society. So that was something new to them. I said, if you are getting 7 lakh, why not make an experiment? If it doesn't run, it was running well because earlier in the MBA department of the university, I started that. 3 years I was running as head of the department. There also, the vice chancellor at that time really pushed me, says, you had come from Calcutta, let us start in the university. But in the university, we had no money available. But this was the opportunity. Friends, I am quoting this not for myself, I am quoting this because it is a hard struggle and opposition also. If you think that I was easy to go ahead, no, it was not so. But finally, it took place. And in 1974, what is known as IMDR, the first ever institute in Maharashtra. Whereas in those days, that was not there. That is not important. Again, I'll go further. My point is, there will be quote Bharamba. IMDR become famous, not because of me, because of that R.K. Doshi. And you know, the liberal attitude of R.K. Doshi. I asked him, what are your conditions for giving 7 lakhs? He said, no reservation of any seat for my students, nothing at all. See how liberal he was. And later on, whenever he came, he didn't enter my cabin. He asked my secretary, please ask Chandrakar if he is free. I have come to Pune. He used to come from Bombay. So much was the modesty and humility. I feel that it's a lesson for you, that those who are really great people, they are modest. They have modesty and humility. It is from that point of view, I always like to advise my young students, don't be arrogant. Don't have complacency. Complacency, hypocrisy, psychophancy, idiosyncrasy, obsolescence, these are the big diseases coming in your area. Don't suffer from complacency. Ye kya ho jayega? Things don't happen so easily. It takes a lot of time. And from that point of view also, let me try to come to the success, is the secret of success. I am not saying that I was successful. I had failure also. But when I had failure, I kept calm, quiet. I said, these days also we'll go, we'll again go ahead. If some student asked me, what should a young student do? I say to them, I am saying it to you, it is not an advice, don't think that I am giving advice. It is born out of my earlier life. First is, commitment should be your culture. Commitment to what? Commitment to your objectives. Immediate objective was, you have to do MBA. Agreed. But commitment to your entire objective. Confidence should be your creed. Confidence. It's so much that you must feel that the world is in your hands. Innovation should be your tradition. Innovation is doing something new. The world is changing so much that yesterday's knowledge is becoming obsolete today. And today's information is going out of date tomorrow. So don't rely on yesterday's information. Innovation should be there. If you remember, there is one Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar. He has kept a big prize for students. What is that? Why? I want students to think innovatively. Something new, innovation should be there. Involvement in your work should be a religion. As I said earlier, modesty and humility should be in your flesh of blood. Nobility should be your strength. Try to be noble. The reason I am putting is, those great people, take any from Einstein to anyone, they were not, what should I say, arrogant. They didn't have that, what you call, a superiority complex. They were modest. You won't recognize that they are so great people. There is one scientist, world known in Pune, Dr. Jayan Narvekar. He is so modest, you won't recognize that he is a world known scientist. This is what I feel, that you must not forget what is the real secret of our success. Well, friends, what are your challenges? Are there any challenges? There are. Number one, there is a keen competition in the world. The earlier I said, don't think that you will have a red carpet. Welcome. No. Keen competition is in every profession, in every field. So keen competition. Try to find out the degree of competition, the type of competition. The second challenge, the second problem is jealousy and hatred by your competitors. Particularly when you go to business, you will find lot of jealousy in there. Even your days and my day, people were jealous. Suppose you are successful every time, some people try to create unrest. Some people try to create problems. Another problem for you is stress and strain. Stress is always there. Now in your MBA course also, so much stress will be there. You have to learn a lot, go for the examination. But even otherwise, the life is full of stress. Stress is always welcome, provided you understand how to beat that stress. And some people have family life, family problems, you know. But going further, what is my philosophy? If you ask me, what do I? I'm not a great man. I am giving my philosophy as an ordinary man. I only say, this is really sincerely I'm saying, I have never taken part in agri competition. If some of my colleagues, they want to go ahead, I say go. I'll lag behind. Nothing, you get your turn. My philosophy there is, philosophy is full of love, full of service, full of sacrifice, full of devotion. I'm using big words. I'm saying this because I was influenced, because I have one hobby that I was to read so many books if possible. Marathi, English, and I had read Swami Vivekananda, I had read Yogi Aravinda, and I was in close touch with that Sindhi leader who died before now. What is it? So he died at the age of 99. And at the age of 98, I had seen him. Sadhu Vaswani. He has strong memory. And he remembered that he had invited me for a lecture in his college 50 years back, when his first just started. And he was so humble. He won't believe. I couldn't believe. When he started going, he touched my feet also. I said, come on, I am a small man. He said, no. There is godliness in everyone. You have touched my feet, so my duty is to touch your feet. So humility. I am talking, giving you extreme example. So I am saying, please do it if possible. Your life should be a life of love. Your life should be a life of sacrifice. Your life should be of service. Service to anyone. Even service to ordinary man on the road. Service to one beggar, service to those who are in the hospital. What do I do when I am free now? First, I like to interact with everyone, people. I am fond of people. For Dr. Shirode knows it. If he doesn't come to me for 1 year, I remember and say, come. I like to talk to the young children, giving them the stories, and they flock me. They don't necessarily require chocolate. They want stories. I meet very old people, dormitories. There are dormitories for old people. They are of my age. They are suffering because we know why they are suffering. Nobody goes and meet them. So So it is my duty, I feel, I must go and meet them. I go to the hospital and there I find how the world is. Aging patients are there. This is not that. So many people are meeting, but I am appealing to you. Try to find out how you will develop love and sacrifice for the people and they will enjoy your life. Coming to challenges, you have got some challenges. I only say that, I already said, addition to love and affection. Liberate your mind from fear. Some or other we are afraid of fear. Anything. I am afraid of cockroaches. I am afraid of lizard. My goodness. So much so that I can't rest, take good sleep if I find some cockroaches there. Just a small example. Liberate your mind from fear. Liberate your mind from hatred. Liberate your mind from anxiety. Liberate your mind from jealousy. This is all. What else? Have a strong sense of humor. Don't show your face, ugly face. Enjoy. Humor is a great strength of bringing people together. So have a sense of humor. Avoid the strain, stress. Take it lightly. Accept the failures. Did I not have failures? Yes, I had. Even now I feel I couldn't get everything that I wanted. Accept the failures. Follow certain values in life. Something that I said earlier, right from removing your complacency, hypocrisy. Accept certain failures in your life. Follow certain values in your life. These values are very important. I am not talking about religious values. Social values. Follow certain values. And one more that is serious in this way, there should be no superstition. Believe in logic. No superstition. As I look around, I find this country today was bogged down by all kinds of superstitions. Bapus and Bahas and all these Asaram Bapu and these things. People are, you know, under the influence of these superstitious people. Even otherwise. God is there. People ask me, do you believe in God? Yes, I believe in God. But I don't go to the temples. This is not that I am having security. I go to the temples to see whether the statue is beautiful. But I don't go to the temple because most of our temples are not clean. On the other hand, masjid and churches, they are clean. And when I go to the church, I find beautiful atmosphere there. The point is, I need not go to the temple at all. I believe in God. I don't describe what God is. I believe in nature. Nature is something which controls your life, which controls your mind. So as I said, follow certain values. Be satisfied with what you get. Don't go on asking for more. Can I say one or two more things before I conclude? Feel relaxed. Sometimes we are so much under the pressure, examination pressure, getting a job pressure, getting how my boss will take, all kinds of pressures there. Feel relaxed. Do not have inferiority complex. Just as I said, no superiority complex, but no inferiority complex also. Try to see that. You can control your mind. Yes, have faith in God. But have faith in yourself. Do you have faith in yourself? Even students say, sir, I can't know what I am. I said, have faith in you. God is there. Have faith in God. But have faith in you. This is what is required. And therefore, while concluding, I would say, I don't know whether you would accept my advice. This is advice, you can take it. But before that, I must say, my name is Judy. See how we have to face the struggle. I am now 90, but up to age of 87, 3 years back, I used to walk fast and I used to take running exercise. I used to walk on the inside of Ferguson College. And some of it happened that I started having pains in my both knees. I went to the doctor for knee replacement. He said, now you are 87, there is no guarantee. So please follow on. Tolerate. I had no alternative but to suffer from what my problem, pains in my knees. But do I suffer? No, I don't suffer. People are there to help me. I like to meet in public. I like to go for lecture. I look, like to go around. I have assistants to assistant. They take me in my car. I move around. The point I am making is, some of you, just as I am, may have some problem. Forget that problem and try to find out how you will become happier and more useful to the society by doing others. As I said earlier, I am repeating it. I move around. People know that I can't walk comfortably. But they are not teasing. They hold my hand. But they want me to come to the public. So remember that if you have any problem, personal problem, family problem, forget that problem. Find out the alternative. And if you find out that alternative, you will find that your life is enjoyable. Am I enjoying my life? Really, I'm enjoying. Who would believe that at the age of 90, I still go to the office, give my lecture to the students, try to look my president of six management, six institutes. I'm not quoting what my biography, I'm not quoting. What I'm quoting is, in spite of severe pain, even now I'm suffering, severe pain in my knees, I forget that. I forget the people. I remember the people. I remember my society. I remember so many visitors coming, he knows it. When I come to the office, so many visitors are. Think if somebody wants a job, somebody wants some admission, but even otherwise, I don't get angry with this. Admission is a big problem. So if a person comes and says, sir, give me the admission in BMCC, in such and such. I said, then I try to explain how difficult it is in my hands, it's not in my hands, to give admission. Anyway, the point I am making is, finally, the last four lines of me, and then I'll conclude. I will say, see, you will understand that. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. Serenity means peace of mind. Let me have peace of mind. If I cannot change. Just now I have given you example of my knees. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. The courage to change the things I can. Yes, if I can change the things, I must have the courage. Be bold, go ahead. Have that confidence. A little while ago I said confidence should be your creed. So, God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference between the two. I have kept this advice for me. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. So I don't get worried, I don't get angry, I don't get nervous if I cannot do some of the things. I hope. I have talked about because I was specifically told, I think by Professor Vignesh, Biju Pillai. Biju Pillai has come here. He is there.
He is traveling.
I am quoting this because I said, why should I say about my life? And they said, you should speak about your life. I don't know whether my life, it is not an ideal life. But at the same time, it is something unique. And I feel that every one of you sitting here and here, let me hope God bless you forever, and let me hope that you will that. Be successful in your life. Again I say, God bless you forever. Thank you very much.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my name is Sajal Kumar, and I want to ask one question, that is, sir, why only 7% of management graduates are employable in India, and what role our professors can play to raise this employability percentage?
Professors, because professors are like yourself, beacon lights. Professor can help you. They know the world of industry, and they may try to inform you about the possible vacancies, but that apart, they would try to advise you on what qualities you have or what qualities you don't have for getting the jobs. I think the main job of all professors, including me, is not to give a particular job. It may be difficult. But to analyze your plus and minus points, your SWOT analysis, strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. If I know the student well, I can understand his strong points. Suppose somebody is very strong as an engineering student. He doesn't want to take HR or marketing. He wants to go to technical subject. I say, since you are an engineer, since you like this, go again to the technical side. This is what professors can do. Of course, in your institute, I am told it's a good thing. Placement is excellent. So be sure that your professor, your institute, your president, all of them are there, fully involved. They have a challenge that everyone must be placed. And so far, no exaggeration, so far in this institute, placement has been near 100%. Exception may be there. So have a strong sense of confidence that you are belonging to this institute, and therefore your future is going to be bright. Okay?
I can't hear. Sir, I have a question on education system of India, sir, especially for the schools. So like the education system in European countries and Japan, it's quite efficient. But when we see our education system for the schools, they're not providing such competency for the global market. So, as per you,
our educational system has not changed.
Yes, sir.
Since the British rule. See the examination system. You are always under tension. Examination system has been examination system has been already changed in foreign countries. They have open book system. They don't believe in catching you by giving unexpected questions. Open book system is there. They have nothing like pass and fail. You know, in many institutes abroad, they give the grades A, B, C, D and E. D and means actually it's a fail. But they don't say fail or pass. If you have D certificate or E certificate, you can appear for examination and improve your grade. Here we are at tension. You are told you have failed in the examination. That fail, that word, is a great irritating word. The point you have asked me, if I understood it correctly, educational system in foreign countries, particularly Western countries, I don't know about Australia, the education system has undergone several changes. Unfortunately, we are rather orthodox. Take the case of even Maharashtra government. So many changes need to be done, but they have not been made. So, here again you are under that period where you have to undergo that tension, appearing for examination, receiving unexpected questions in the paper. I feel that this is a sort of great punishment for the young student. But you can't avoid it now. You can't change it. In my days also it was not changed. You know, in my days what was the rule? There were 10 papers for BCom or MCom. If I had failed in one paper, I was required to appear for all 10 papers. This is not solved. Fortunately, it has been liberalized. It was such a tension we had. If I fail in one paper, I have to give all 10 papers. I think in chartered accountants course, that rule is still there. If you fail in one paper, you have to appear for all papers. So I feel this needs to be changed. You are right when you say that let us try to understand what they are doing. Of course, it's a big question. Your professors can discuss with you later on. Okay.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, my question is...
Loudly.
Yeah. Sir, my question is that you mentioned in your speech that you got an opportunity to meet Peter Drucker. So
Peter
what...
Drucker.
Yeah, sir?
Opportunity to see Peter Drucker.
Yeah, you got an opportunity, you said.
Yeah.
In your, and so what were the valuable inputs you got from him which you could share with us?
Now, it is difficult to remember because I was in 1963 when I heard Peter Drucker. But I will only say... I have read Peter Drucker, but I will add one more point. You know how they have a liberal mind. My professor colleagues will remember this. At the time of Britain, at the time of send-off, what do we naturally do? Professor sit in the chair, students stand behind. Will you believe that all our professors, there were five or six American professors. They stood behind and asked some of us, since I was nominated as secretary, I was asked to sit in the middle of the chair. All chairs were occupied by students and all professors were sitting behind. See how they are following novel methods. Here what has happened is we are orthodox. You follow certain procedures. And then we get bogged down. We become slave of us, ourselves. So many things are there. I think it will take a lot of time for all the people in the larger society to change your attitude. Your attitude is the attitude of Britishers. Britishers are very conservative, believe me. Americans are not to that extent. Americans say hi to even anyone. British are not. So it is difficult to, it is interesting to learn from people of all sorts. If you get an opportunity to move in the world, you will learn something from Britishers, something from Americans, something from Africans. Even Africans have come. Do you know that when France has got this, became the World Cup leader in football, there were 10 players in the team of France who were from Africa, origin from Africa. So the world has become, now it is not the monopoly of Britishers or white people, even the black people, and they are not behind. There is so much, you know, conservatism about black and white. But the black people, they have gone ahead and they have done miraculous success in science and technology also. So let us be confident. If at all some of you go abroad, some of you may come across that they have superiority complex, but it will go ahead. You should do your work nicely, they will appreciate it. They do appreciate. My granddaughter is in Denver for the last 14 years. He has now been appointed as general manager. There are all your American people there working under him. So that if you work well, you don't come across that discrimination. My granddaughter is in New York. What is she doing? She is in jewelry business. She left a job there. And under her, there are five American girls. I asked her, are they working? She said, yes, they are working nicely. So point that I'm making is, if you show your quality, if you go ahead, this discrimination will not be there. So let us be confident, okay?
Good evening, sir. Thank you for sparing your valuable time for us. Sir, I've always believed that even one person can make a difference. And like you said, that sometimes we need to have the sanity that some things we cannot change. So how do we bring about that sanity that what things are unchangeable for us?
I agree that the person, God grant the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. Now, if you cannot change at all, try to overcome, don't have the tension. Accept it. I am not using my own example. Can I walk comfortably now? In my whole life, I will not. So what I am doing is trying to find alternative ways of becoming happy. So this is the way that you have to do it.
Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwara, Gurur Sakshat Param Brahma Tasmai Shri Guruve Nama. With these lines, I, Aniket Joshi, Student Manager, Shri Balaji Society, deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion. First and foremost, I would like to thank our special guest, Dr. P.C. Sejwalkar, sir, who despite having his busy schedule, has found time to grace this occasion. I also express my heartfelt thank to our beloved Bala sir for his unleashed support. Sejwalkar sir, I would thank you for being a guide, a supporter, a guru, and for imparting an inculcable amount of knowledge and motivation, not only to us, but to many of the corporates across the world, through all the walks of the life. As we all have heard that age is an issue of mind over matter. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter. Sir, your life has been an inspiration to all of us, and it teaches us how via will, determination, and dedication, one can grow from roots of ground to the zenith. Sir, the knowledge and blessings that you have showered upon all of us, which I am sure will definitely create a huge impact on our life. Thank you, sir. We will be looking forward for many more interactions with you. Thank you.